We're not okay.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this week 9 of Global Pediatric Lecture Series. And we are now into week 9 and we're going good. Thank you all of you for joining from many different parts of the world and supporting this. And thanks to all the speakers and experts at ALDA-K who have been contributing every single week so far. So as you know, this is every week, every Wednesday, 4 o'clock UK time. One of the experts from ALDA-K will be talking on common pediatric topics, which should be of interest to the pediatricians around the globe. So it's my pleasure today to introduce my friend and colleague, Professor Ian Sinha, who is a respiratory physician at ALDA-K. He's going to talk to us about management of asthma. Ian has a varied interest and he leads the National Asthma Audit and he's a national international expert in the field of childhood asthma. He got passion in improving social deprivation and he leads the National Asthma Audit and he has been promoted as a professor recently. So he's going to talk to us about management of childhood asthma and cover some of the latest aspects.
Thank you very much, Senthil, and thank you for the invitation to come along today. When we heard you were putting on this global series, we were all really excited in ALDA-K. It's a huge thing to do, and we know how hard you work to get it on. So thank you for the invite and for doing that. And good afternoon, everybody, or good afternoon where I am anyway, which is in my house in Liverpool. And thanks for logging in to talk about a condition that I think is A, fascinating, and B, really needs a lot of work doing around it. It's exactly the right time to go into pediatric asthma. And thank you all for coming. Let me see there. So just before we move on to the talk itself, I know there are people from different countries and I didn't want to really dictate what should happen in asthma. You know, what happens in the UK will be different to what happens in Sweden, will be different to what happens in the Middle East, in Australia, Latin America, Africa, every different continent and every country within that continent and the rural and urban areas will have their differences in the difficulties and challenges and opportunities for asthma. But just one slide to show that this is why we need talks on asthma in 2020. The burden of asthma and the morbidity and mortality from asthma is still unacceptable. You know, there are over 300 million children with asthma. It's the most common chronic condition of childhood, both in developing countries and in terms of non-communicable diseases in developing countries and low and middle income countries. And there's been some amazing epidemiological work, which I won't go into in detail in this talk, but in essence, from the Global Initiative for Asthma, and they produced the Global Asthma Report, showing that over the last 15, 20 years, things have improved in most countries or in many countries with regards mortality from asthma. But there is still variation across the world. There's still variation even within countries. So if you look at the high income countries, for example, there is still variation and some countries have improved more than others. There is still a need to get asthma right. We want to give children their best life and we want to prevent avoidable deaths. So it's really important to us to try and get asthma right. And my talk really is about some of what I think are the fundamental aspects of asthma. Talking through initially the clinic that I'm lucky enough to work with here in Liverpool and the ethos of that clinic, to talk through some of the issues around diagnosis and management of asthma, and then to briefly touch on something that is very close to my heart and the heart of many people who work in Liverpool, which is one of the most deprived, socially economically deprived cities in the UK. And that topic is the socioeconomic and wider determinants of asthma. And very briefly to talk about acute asthma. So I've got no financial interests to declare. I do talk about treatments later. The other things to just declare, so in terms of research, I'm a chief investigator on some studies which I'll come on to, and I'm the clinical lead for the Children and Young Persons Asthma Audit. And just a quick nod to that group. So the Children and Young Persons Asthma Audit is part of a national audit program around respiratory outcomes in adults and children. It's by far the largest audit of its type. And I work very closely with someone called Sharon, who works really hard. Sharon Affle works really hard behind the scenes to pull together some data for the pediatric audit. I won't be discussing that here because it's still under embargo, but I do touch on some of the concepts and do look out for that because it will be a really important document coming out. And the other acknowledgement to just give is to my team, some of whom are on this picture here. This picture was taken this morning. They're currently either watching me or watching the European Respiratory Society meeting in one of our seminar rooms down there. Some of you may have been to our hospital. For those of you who are either in the UK or globally, if you ever happen to be in the Northwest, do drop us a line. If you want to come and see us in Alderhay once all this COVID is finished and we're back to a new normal, do come and say hello. We would love to meet you. We would love to exchange ideas and cross-pollinate ideas, and you'd be most welcome. And this is that team. And this is the first point that I want to make about the fundamentals of asthma. I think if my colleagues, if my multidisciplinary colleagues decided that they didn't want to see asthma anymore, I would be completely stuck. There is zero chance, absolutely zero chance, I would be able to manage manage asthma well without this multidisciplinary team. So we have within our team some medics, we have pharmacists, nurses, physiotherapists, and psychologists. We also work closely with physiology, and we work closely with other specialties in the hospital. So I am completely spoiled when I walk into clinic. By the time I've seen a child with asthma, 5, 10, 15 other people have seen them, got the basics right, and I have actually not that much to offer to their cases. You can see us on these other pictures winning some awards. That's a testament really to the multidisciplinary team, who have been absolutely world class, and I mean that in its truest sense. They're world leaders in what they do, and it brings so much to the care of children with asthma. And this is the first bit of our ethos. Our feeling is that managing asthma is 33% inhaled steroids, 33% healthy living, 33% self-esteem, 1% everything else. And over the next few slides, I just want to give some examples of that. So the first thing we do is that we try to bring it all back to the pathophysiology. When I was at medical school in the late 1990s, this picture of the cat with an arrow and someone having an asthma attack, that's kind of all we knew. And in that arrow, it would say inflammation. That's all we really knew, that there was some inflammatory process that led to asthma problems. What we know now is that it's more complex than that. And there are still lots of unknowns. It's a really exciting area of research. But I just wanted to highlight three things about the pathophysiology that we talk about in clinic. So the first is this. The first is circled in the pink circle, number one, is that in people who truly have asthma, there are problems with the epithelia. The epithelia should act as a barrier that protect the airway, but in people with asthma and in people who are atopic, that barrier doesn't work so well. So aero irritants that the child breathes in cause a problem to children with asthma. Why is that important? Well, it's because we need to absolutely focus on avoidance of things that are irritating to the airway. That's a great way to try and prevent asthma problems. The second pink circle you see here is Th2 and the B cell and the eosinophils. We've started to learn that there are different cellular processes that happen in asthma, and different people have different proportions to which those varying cellular problems cause them issues, and they respond to treatment in different ways. The third circle is about interleukin 17, and this is amongst other interleukins associated with a chronic recruitment process, almost, whereby when you have asthma, there's a chronic recruitment of inflammatory cells. And then when we move across to this other picture, which is the biopsy of an airway, what we see is the typical features that we describe in asthma. So mucus hypertrophy, airway muscle hypertrophy, and narrow airways. But what we know over time, we've learned that not all people with asthma are the same. And of all the sort of things that I do in my job, including research, quality improvement, audit, teaching, the thing that really gives me and most of you, I'm sure, the biggest buzz is seeing patients. And it's really exciting when you've not met a patient for them to come in, and before they come in, you're thinking, oh, you know, I wonder what the problem might be. I wonder how they'll present. What we are starting to move towards is the idea of asthma as being a little bit of a dustbin diagnosis, and different children have different problems. And this leads us on to how we've started thinking about phenotyping in the clinic. I think this is really exciting, and I keep talking to our guys about it and in the clinic, and I think they like it. I'm sure they'll tell me afterwards, but I kind of do their head in because I'm really excited about this at the moment, the idea that we can pictorially differentiate between children. I won't talk through this in detail, but basically for each child, we, across the top here in case one, you can see this histogram. We basically look at their symptoms, their asthma attacks, their obstruction and inflammation each year, and we score them from 0, which is, you know, no problems, to 3, which is quite severe. And what we see are varying patterns of children. So this is in our more difficult regional asthma clinic. But if you look at case one, you see all those bars are pretty high. And this is what we would expect to see. Someone with lots of symptoms, lots of exacerbations, but also lots of obstruction, lots of inflammation. You move down to case two, and you see a child who has quite significant obstruction with that purple bar, but not much in the way of symptoms and exacerbations now. But what we know about this child, looking at the growth chart, is the BMI is through the roof. Like, this is a morbidly obese child with bronchiectasis. If you look at case three, you see someone with very significant symptoms and exacerbations, but no physiological markers of asthma at all. And conversely, if you look at case four, you see someone who thinks he's fine, but has a, you know, has some of the worst lung function in the clinic. So there are different groups of children with different patterns, and how you treat them varies. This is one of the constants that we say. Our feeling is that alongside medication, which I'll come to, healthy living is really, really important. We focus on inflammation. We give children drugs to target this inflammation. We also know that diet, good diet, is anti-inflammatory. Poor diet is pro-inflammatory. Good diet, exercise, sleep, and reducing stress are all important in reducing inflammation. And one of my colleagues, Claire Hepworth, who's a specialist physio therapist, has just this week been presenting this poster at the European Respiratory Meeting, looking at the levels of obesity and overweight and low fitness in our clinic, and they're staggeringly high. You know, nearly half our kids are overweight or obese, nearly half our kids have got very low levels of fitness. And this is some of my colleagues with me, so Dr. Thursfield, Professor Semple, and Claire Hepworth, I've just mentioned. Before COVID, we were dishing out fruit in the clinic to children. And it wasn't because we thought that one apple every 3 months would make them better. It was just to make them think that fruit is important enough for us to buy it and give it to them. And if you look at this picture here, this is me with my colleague, who you've seen on some of the other slides. This is Dr. Chris Grime, who's a leading expert in sleep medicine and has a real passion in improving sleep for children. He's also, as you can see, a very fit man. But the story behind this picture was, you see me standing on that step. We do that step test for children when they come to clinic. We look at their fitness, we look at their breathing. And one day we decided to have a challenge in the clinic, and I beat Dr. Grime at doing the most steps in a minute. So that's my triumphant photo, and that's why he looks so sad on there. But these are really important things to us. It's not just about medication, it's about everything. Steroids are not a treatment for poor sleep. You know, biologics aren't a treatment for obesity. You have to address asthma holistically. And this is some work from one of my other colleagues, Dr. Lucy Gate, who is a clinical psychologist. We focus very much on empowerment, and this is a paper she published in archives with our team just a couple of months ago. This is our approach to empowering children. We say empowerment is making sure that children are able to manage themselves without seeking help, that they're able to tailor their asthma around their life rather than the other way around. They want to live their life. They don't want to be a child with asthma who happens to do something else. They want to do the things they do, and we need to help them have asthma as just an extra consideration. And we need to enable children to make shared decisions. Okay, so gone are the days when we can follow a flowchart and go, this is what you need next. We need to be listening to children. We need to be listening to parents as well, but absolutely we need to listen to children about their thoughts on treatment and their treatment goals. And if you have a few minutes, I would really like to signpost you to that paper. You see one of the other names on that paper, Dr. Justice Simba, is a consultant in Nairobi, who was with us for a few months as a European Respiratory Society fellow, and we worked together very closely. We very much missed Justice being around, but Justice has gone back to Kenya with some great ideas about quality improvement in the area that he lives in, and with his colleagues who sound fantastic, and I would absolutely love to meet them one day. And again, I think this comes from when we start working together. We learned a lot about medicine as well from Justice coming. So do keep in touch with us after this talk if you're interested. So that's how our clinic works. We're all about empowerment, healthy living, phenotyping, making sure we get the right treatment. But how do you get the diagnosis right? This will be, even today, there will be thousands of children having a virtual consultation with a doctor somewhere who will be scratching their head going, I don't know if this is asthma or not. There are loads of guidelines. They all say different things. Some of the tenets are about the same. And this is my take on diagnosis of asthma. First thing is that the key thing of all of this is the history. And within a history of asthma, it's the stuff that you've known for years. The dry cough, wheeze, chest tightness. It's unusual to get uncontrolled asthma in someone who's non-atopic, and variability of symptoms is important. These are really the five key bits of the history. The difficulty is when you start to shoehorn other symptoms into a diagnosis of asthma. So if you were to look at the kinds of cases where people get stuck, quite often it's a child with a wet cough. Or when you ask about the wheeze, it's not a wheeze, it's a crackle or a rattle or a stridor, and we'll come on to that. And with chest tightness, when we think about shortness of breath, I've stopped really thinking about shortness of breath as being a symptom of asthma, and I've started thinking of chest tightness as being a symptom of asthma. When we think about tests, there are various tests we can do to look for markers of type 2 inflammation. So eosinophils, nitric oxide, skin prick testing, and IgE and RASC testing. And knowing whether those tests are positive or negative can be helpful. They're not completely foolproof, but they can be helpful. And knowing the presence or absence of airway obstruction also, can be useful, but it may not be useful. Sometimes that throws up more confusion than you had before. You'll see in that box there about obstruction, I've said FEV1, FVC, Z score. I'm going to talk about that on this slide. If you look at the quality of these tests for making a diagnosis of asthma, you've got a group of kids who clearly have asthma from the history. That's fine. Do whatever test you want. If it looks and smells like asthma, it probably is. It's nice to have some objective measurement. And if the story is barn door classical for asthma, you probably can find some objective thing to back you up. But if you look at the group who are where you're on the fence, you're sitting on the fence, you don't know whether they've got asthma or not, what you really need to do is for a test to push you this way. So you say, no, it's not asthma. or to push you this way and say this is asthma. And if you look at the statistics, really from the evidence, which is small amounts of evidence, you know, there is not loads of evidence around this, but markers of airway obstruction are probably less useful than markers of airway inflammation at making that diagnosis or undiagnosing asthma. And all of these tests in isolation are probably no better than flicking a coin and saying heads, it's asthma, tails, it's not asthma. The history and your pre-test kind of thinking about this child is crucial. This picture here about spirometry, traditionally we talk about an FEV1-FVC ratio of 0.7, which is great if you are aged 50 or older. It's a great thing for older people, for children. It misses children with very significant levels of obstruction, and it doesn't take into account genetic variation. So if you are in a centre where you're doing spirometry, I think thinking about moving towards Z scores is an important way to go, and the Global Lung Initiative. Just a quick point about peak flow. I know many of you will use peak flow. We don't use it routinely in our clinic, but I get that in some places it's, you know, either in primary care or in other countries, it's widely used. I think we don't know enough about peak flow to know how to use it best, but the traditional markers are not great. So that's why we haven't gone down that route. You can't do a talk about asthma these days without at least attempting to discuss preschool asthma. Preschool asthma is a massive headache. Oh my God, preschool diagnosis of asthma is so difficult. It's only recently really that we're starting to see some more changes in this field. This is the algorithm that we started using in our region based on evidence. What we say is, look, it's going to be difficult to say yes or no, it's asthma. These kids are on a spectrum. 50% of children wheeze in their preschool years. Some of them will be like children with asthma. Some of them will be like children with episodic wheeze. And these are the three key questions. What are they like when they're well? Typically speaking, a child who's more like a child with asthma will have interval symptoms of cough, wheeze, chest tightness. Are the exacerbations severe or frequent? Again, you know, in episodic wheeze, it tends not to be that bad. If they're having severe or frequent exacerbations, it may be more like a child with asthma. And the presence or absence of type 2 inflammation, and on the basis of a recent study called the Infant Trial, a good marker here is serum eosinophils. If they don't have markers of inflammation, you might move a little bit more towards episodic wheeze. If they do have markers of inflammation, as listed here, move more towards preschool asthma. But we'll come on to that in a few slides. So the next thing is to say that is important is that all children with asthma should be on inhaled corticosteroids. And this is because excess salbutamol itself, and you know, with or without steroids, but excess salbutamol without inhaled steroids is associated with an increased risk of death. And there have been at least two historical episodes over the last 50, 60 years where there were spikes of death in children and adults. And when you look at it, it's because they weren't taking inhaled steroids. We know from the evidence that inhaled steroids reduces exacerbations. And the key thing is that if given via an inhaler, they should be given, by a metered dose inhaler, they should be given through a spacer. I'm going to come on to some of those things, but I just want to, at this point, move in to a particular hot topic around asthma. In the GINA guidelines, as I'm sure many of you know, there is now a recommendation based on adult and adolescent studies that inhaled steroids can, in mild asthma, be given intermittently. It's a very good rationale behind it, and there is good adult and adolescent data, particularly adult data. But is that right? Are we sure that moving from daily steroids, saying to our families, take these steroids every day, to intermittent steroids, saying, take these steroids when you have symptoms, are we sure that's right in children? And I'm not sure. And there are three reasons why I say that. Firstly, maintenance inhaled steroids might be more effective in children than they are in adults. So if you look at the adult studies, they found no difference in mild asthma in the rates of asthma attacks. They did find a worsening in asthma control when you move towards intermittent steroids, but in terms of asthma attacks, maintenance inhaled steroids were no better. They found no difference. But one thing I would say is maintenance inhaled steroids may be more beneficial at population level for children with asthma, because as we've just said, you know, the presence of inflammation is really important. There are phenotypes of adult asthma where inflammation is less important. The second thing is, if you look at the evidence about intermittent increases in steroids in adults, that works. Quintupling or quadrupling the dose of steroids at the first signs of a viral infection or a worsening of asthma control works well. It doesn't really work that well in randomized control trials and in control studies in children. So intermittent increases may work better in adults than children. And the third thing is that the inhaler they were using in the adult study, a dry powder inhaler, is difficult sometimes for children to use. It's less easy than using a metered dose inhaler and spacer for a lot of children. So just the logistics of doing this differ. And we did this meta-analysis, which is currently unpublished. We did it as part of a grant application. But what we found was that they're probably, in the four studies comparing these strategies in children, there probably is no real difference. But we don't know. They're smaller studies, and if we look at all of them, they're all slightly different to how we would do things in the UK. So on the basis of that, we have now got funding for a randomized control trial, which will be one of the largest randomized control trials in children with asthma. This is hopefully going to start in January. And it's called the asymptomatic study. This is the first time, you're the first people to ever hear about this apart from our colleagues. And there'll be some press releases coming out about this in the next 2 days. But in essence, keep your eyes peeled for the asymptomatic study, which will be a large randomized control trial, 1800 kids, funded by the National Institute of Health Research. And I'm happy to talk through that separately. So looking through preschool wheeze again, you know, what about these kids? Who should be on steroids? What we agreed is in our regional network was that if it looks like episodic wheeze, there's no evidence for giving those kids inhaled steroids at all. If it looks like they've got asthma, then you should treat with steroids, particularly if you've got markers of inflammation and atopy. And in this gray group in the middle, the unclear or mixed picture, we've said that an serum eosinophilia and IgE RASD tests should be done. And if they're negative, don't treat them with asthma for asthma. If they're positive and suggestive of inflammation, treat for asthma. That's what the current evidence would suggest to us. So always use steroids. But let's say they're not controlled on steroids. There's a tendency sometimes to just ramp up treatment, and we need to stop that. Before stepping up or changing treatment in someone with uncontrolled asthma, these are the questions to ask. Number one, is it asthma? Number two, is there a comorbidity? Number three, are they taking their steroids and are they taking them properly? Number four, do they know what to do during an asthma attack? Have you written down a plan for how to self-manage and empower them? And number five, are there wider things affecting their asthma? These are some examples of things that we see. Many of you will have done a talk called All That Wheezes Isn't Asthma. Well, you know, all that coughs isn't asthma either, and all that is breathless isn't asthma either. It comes down to this history. We have found various significant problems in children with atypical stories for asthma. It's too easy to say that someone has got asthma without kind of delving into the history in more detail. And when things don't fit, it might be a significant suppurative problem like CF. They might have an upper airway problem like malacia or vocal cord dysfunction. They might have dysfunctional breathing. They might have anxiety and depression. They might have, you know, something rare like Churg-Strauss syndrome. They might have a tumor. They might have all of these things. And we miss children or delay picking up significant problems if we don't question the diagnosis each time. Non-response to asthma treatment should make you wonder whether it's asthma at all. This is the kind of picture we don't want to see, a child taking a spacer in the mouth directly. Every day someone tags me on Twitter and says, look at this ridiculous picture, and they're exactly right. Children, when they're having steroids through metered dose inhaler, must have them through a spacer. And one of our collaborators in Colombia, he's a fantastic respiratory pediatrician and also an expert in cost effectiveness, has been looking at homemade spacers. So in countries where spacers are prohibitively expensive for families, just cutting a hole, there's more to it than that, but cutting a hole in a bottle of Coke once you've finished it is just as effective and better than just putting the inhaler in your mouth. Spacers. Asthma management falls short in thousands of children because we don't push spacers. Jumping on a couple of steps, ICS Labber is a hot topic. What ICS Labber do you use? For years, there's been this kind of thing where if they don't respond to like Seretide, Tradamom, Flutiform, and still have it twice a day, none of that works. There's no difference in and of itself between anything in any of the inhalers. The difference comes when you start to use those inhalers in different regimes. And we are probably our favored approach is to use the MART regime, the maintenance and reliever therapy regime. And that's because giving children inhalers which have a steroid plus a fast-acting, long-acting beta agonist, mainly formoterol, really. But giving children inhalers with formoterol and steroids means that they can use that inhaler as their reliever therapy. That's because formoterol acts probably about as fast as salbutamol in most children. And we like this regime because we say to them, this is your only inhaler. You use it as your only inhaler. Take it twice a day. Take it when you've got symptoms. We know that a lot of them don't take it twice a day. They just use it for symptoms. And that's fine because they're at least getting steroids. We are forcing them to have steroids by doing it this way, not forcing them, that we're making them have steroids by doing it this way. And you have a significant reduction in the risk of asthma attacks. You need to do that for six children with uncontrolled asthma to prevent one of them having asthma attacks. Another strategy is to use a new inhaler called Relvar, which is from GSK and has an ultra long acting high dose inhaled steroid and long acting beta agonist. We use that less. We have some kids on it. They take it once a day, which has its advantages for some children. But the evidence was less striking to us than the MART regime. So that's why most of our kids try on the MART regime. One of my colleagues, Vicky Worrell, has done some work with a medical student to present our outcomes from switching to MART, and they've been quite impressive. And that's being presented again at the European Respiratory Meeting. I've got one slide on biologics. People get really excited about biologics. Across the UK, across the world, there are children with significant asthma who need to step up to this level of treatment, but they are few and far between. Most asthma can be treated by putting children on the right inhaled steroids, by putting children on a regime of healthy living where they can, and by putting children on steroids that they can take appropriately with a spacer. But there will still be some children. Going back to this idea of the pathology of asthma, we've used, and other centres have used, interleukin-5 blockers, mepolizumab, interleukin-4 and 13 blockers. So we've had a child on dupilumab, which has worked really well. IgE blockers, so Xolair, omalizumab works very well. We've had children on tiotropium and different strategies for bronchodilation. They work very well. All these things work very well if you get the kid at the right time. Once you've worked up the rest of it, once you've worked up the basics, once you've tried to get them healthy, once you've tried to get them to take their inhalers in other ways, if you're still failing and they still have severe treatment-resistant asthma, this is the way to go. And one of our colleagues and collaborators and friends in London, Sejal Siglani, Professor Siglani, has started a trial called a TREAT study to compare different approaches to this level of asthma. And we look forward to contributing to that and seeing that. But this is the other mantra that I have. Like, no biologic for any condition in the world is a treatment for obesity, living in a broken home, anxiety, non-adherence to treatment, or poverty. And poverty is where it's at. For me, we will not win when it comes to childhood asthma outcomes or even childhood asthma incidence until we start focusing on the wider determinants of health in early life. These are things that increase the risk of children having asthma and increase the risk of children having severe asthma and increase the risk of children having asthma attacks. So antenatal stress, postnatal stress and family chaos, antenatal and postnatal smoking. Sorry, my daughter is playing a flute or something. I recorded that. I'm sorry if that comes through. Antenatal smoking, postnatal smoke exposure, poor housing quality, air pollution, obesity in infancy, obesity in adolescence. These are things that drive asthma. These are the reasons why I think we're diagnosing asthma more. And these are things that are inextricably linked to poverty. Certainly in the developed world, in high income countries, these are things that are linked with poverty. And some of you have seen a talk that I did recently about poverty and asthma. I'll pick one slide out of that. Here, I just want to think about the fact that living in poverty, there is increasing evidence about the epigenetics of doing this. In other words, living in poverty alters your very DNA. It alters the fabric of your DNA, and this is generational. And this picture here is from a poster by Philippe. Philippe Lawrence is a really specialist physiologist who works within our team and has been looking at markers of inflammation, markers of obstruction in poor, sort of socioeconomically deprived postcodes, and found that they are worse in poor postcodes in our clinic. So biological markers of asthma are worse in children living in poverty. And this map is from another colleague of mine, Holly Brown, who has been doing some great work about inequalities in asthma across our cities. But specifically, what can we do to try and ameliorate and get those better? And she's been mapping asthma across the city, and these poor postcodes here are these hotspots here in red are areas of high morbidity and high poverty, and that I think is largely driven by biological factors and also other things, you know, lifestyle and things like that. But we absolutely need to move away from the idea. There's a narrative in the UK that children who live in poverty who are unhealthy because of parental ignorance or parental laziness. It's absolutely not true. It is so untrue, and it's so dangerous to push this narrative, and children suffer because of it. We need to try and get on top of poverty. One slide about acute asthma, because this is also very important. Two slides. These are the headlines I think about acute asthma. Giving steroids early, as in almost as soon as they arrive in the ED, is important. Giving steroids early prevents the risk of or reduces the risk of hospitalization and deterioration. We, as we'll come on to in the next slide, have switched a few years ago. I think we may have been the first trust in the UK to switch from prednisolone to dexamethasone, and we haven't looked back. It's been a good decision. Giving inhalers instead of nebulizers, if you can, is useful. So children who are hypoxic and have life-threatening asthma, fine, nebulize away. But children who aren't in that category, giving nebulization causes harm. We should be giving inhalers by spacer, and empowering nursing staff to treat and wean salbutamol is the way forward. From the NACAP audit, the National Asthma Audit, we've focused on various things, and I think this is a big red flag. We need to be treating acute admissions for asthma in children as a red flag. Personally, I would do away with the word severe asthma, and I would say mild, moderate asthma attacks that are managed in the community, or life-threatening asthma attacks that require hospitalization. There's some discussion about whether this term is right. For me, there is a complacency around asthma. If you look at other conditions where there are preventable deaths, so sepsis, child abuse, diabetes, these things have got better because people started saying, why are we taking it easy with these kids? You know, why are we just accepting that children get admitted with asthma attacks? The diabetes guys would not accept that in diabetes. You know, the sepsis guys that are doing really well with sepsis would not accept that that is a way forward, and we need to get to that level with asthma. And when we start to think about life-threatening asthma, that's when you start saying, right, let's treat every admission as a red flag. Make sure we check inhaler technique. Make sure we give people a plan so they know what to do when they go home. Let's not send them home on millions of puffs of salbutamol. Let's make sure they're safe. Let's check for smoking. Let's arrange for follow-up. Let's do the basic things that could stop this child coming in for the next, you know, within the next year or 6 months or 1 week or whatever it is. We can stop children coming back and we can stop children dying from asthma. This is the evidence upon which we switched to dexamethasone. There are more up-to-date studies than this, but they don't show anything different. That prednisolone is no better than dexamethasone when it comes to acute asthma attacks. It's one dose, dexamethasone is one dose, so it takes out any issues with non-compliance, and it is better tolerated, so it's less likely to cause vomiting. And it's significantly cheaper in the UK. So we made that switch and we haven't looked back. I'm going to skip through this slide because it probably doesn't fit with the rest of what we're talking about here. But in essence, people spend a lot of time thinking about which IV treatment to use. They're all right. They're not spectacularly good. Some children need IV treatment. And again, we take that very lightly. We take it lightly that children have such life-threatening and refractory asthma that they require intravenous therapy. Those are children who could die from an asthma attack, and we should be using terms like life-threatening asthma. So to sum up, which does leave time for discussion and questions, and I'd be very happy to take any questions, but to sum up, this is our thoughts on asthma. Managing asthma is 33% inhaled steroids. Inhaled steroids are crucial. 33% self-esteem, 33% healthy living, 1% everything else. Get the basics right. That includes focusing on the right history. Tests can help, but they are imperfect. Focusing on the right history and taking a good history every time is important. And taking that before stepping up treatment is crucial. It's crucial to develop a multidisciplinary approach. We cannot do asthma without our asthma nurses, our pharmacists, our physiotherapists, our psychologists, and our physiologists. Having that multidisciplinary approach is what makes children better. And within that, we are able to empower children. And by empowering children, we mean enabling them to manage themselves without seeking our help, enabling them to take part in making shared decisions about their care. No decision about them without them, and making sure that that they can tailor their sort of asthma around their life. We need these children to live their best life. We want them to go through and have a happy, healthy childhood without asthma getting in the way. One medical thing: ensure every child has inhaled steroids. If there's one thing that we can do to improve asthma outcomes, this is it. And like I say, I didn't really take a global view on this, but this is on the WHO list of essential medicines. Every child in the world with asthma should have inhaled corticosteroids and should know how to use them. And address wider determinants of health when we can. And again, this is a massive piece of work, but it's an important piece of work. And it's something that is very close to our hearts, and hopefully over the next few years we'll see some improvement in that. Thank you very much for listening, those of you who stayed through to the end. I hope you found it useful, and I hope these key points are things that that you're either able to do or have generated some thought. Again, we'd be very happy to link with you if you are somewhere else. There's nothing we like better than making friends around the world. So do get in touch if you'd like us to work and collaborate with you and share some ideas. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Very, very inspiring and amazing talk, actually. It was terrific. And it's also impressive to see how you run your clinics in a very holistic manner, not just managing asthma, but also other aspects of the health, including weight management. For the delegates who are listening into the talk, please post your questions in the chat box, and Ian would be happy to answer those questions. While I was waiting for the questions to come through, Ian, I want to ask something. What do you think about the link between the obesity and asthma? Do you think obesity increases the risk of asthma, or is it like the asthma management gets complicated because of obesity?
I think both. I think obesity not just increases the risk of asthma, I think it increases the risk of quite difficult asthma. So if you look at adult phenotypes of asthma, one of their most difficult groups is adults who present in adulthood, typically middle-aged or slightly older females, with obesity, and very difficult to manage asthma. And I think we're seeing a group of those in our difficult asthma clinic. I think some of them are more likely to develop airway inflammation and airway obstruction, and also restrictive lung disease because their chest walls are quite thick. They have worse sleep. Sleep is pro-inflammatory, poor sleep is pro-inflammatory, so I think they have different types of inflammation there. They suffer, so obese children suffer more with issues like self-esteem and bullying, both of which can lead to symptoms that are mimicking asthma or make asthma worse. So I think it does increase the risk of a particular type of asthma, but I think when we find children in the asthma clinic who are obese, it makes it more difficult to get on top of things. And that's why we focus particularly in that group on trying to get those things better. And again, we're not, you know, I'm guessing most people on the call are pediatricians. You will have the same ethos as us. You'll say the same things to kids, which is that we're not really thinking about them now. We are, you know, we want them to have a happy childhood, but we're also thinking about them when they're 40, 50, 60, 70 years old. And in order to prevent them getting, so put it this way, again, when I was at medical school and when you were at medical school, we were taught that COPD is a disease where you have accelerated lung decline in adulthood. What we know over the last couple of years from long-term cohort studies is that half the people with COPD, of all our little colleagues, they're basically just patching up stuff that went wrong when their patients were children, and half the people with COPD just had poor lung function as they entered adulthood. And one of the drivers for that is obesity, and obesity with or without asthma. So I think it's a really interesting question, but I think it's both. I think it increases the risk of asthma and inflammation, makes it more difficult.
Thank you, Ian. I think there are lots of questions coming through actually, so we'll start try and address them. From Anonymous, cereal eosinophil levels, how many times is classed as cereal?
I don't think I said cereal eosinophils. We do them sporadic. So I think we would do them if we were unclear about diagnosis, and we would do them if someone had poorly controlled asthma so that we could phenotype them. But we don't, if a child has got well-controlled asthma, we wouldn't do serum eosinophils. If they've got poorly controlled asthma to the level where we're thinking of either questioning the diagnosis or stepping up to a biologic treatment, then we would do it then.
Okay, next question from Johanna. At what age can a child use a DPI?
So our asthma nurses would be better at answering this question than I would. Our perception is, and what Vicky's poster suggests, is that before the age of about 11, 12, it's difficult. It has been used and can be used, and the research trials have looked at children down to the age of 6. Our perception is that to take a big breath in is more difficult under the age of about 11 or 12. And that causes problems both in terms of getting inhaled steroids in, but also in terms of using the inhaler at times of shortness of breath. So it's more kind of when they move towards high school.
Yeah. Next question from Anonymous. How do you address salbutamol weaning protocols for A&E? Example, 10 puffs every 4 hours times 24, or 6 puffs every 4 hours, and so on.
Yeah, this is a really difficult thing. And I'm not sure that people have been talking about standardizing this approach for a long time, and it's about getting the balance right. So some people will say, look, you know, you need to get this. Why are we sending parents home with high levels of salbutamol when their child is presented with significant symptoms? And they're right. You know, they're saying, why would you send someone home on this dose of salbutamol? On the flip side, as we've seen during COVID, if you overfill your hospitals, other people die. Like, you know, it's really important that we manage our resources well. So I think for me, there's probably two elements to this. One is it's on a case-by-case basis. So if it's a child who lives a billion miles away from a hospital and it's the middle of the night and they've come in with a really severe attack that's responded well, maybe that's not one to send home. I think it varies on the child, it varies on the centre, it varies on how busy the centre is. But I think there's a balancing act between those two things. If we fill our hospital with children who are on weaning protocols for salbutamol over the winter, we won't get anything else done and other children will suffer. So I think it's a balance. But you're right, it's a really hot topic.
Thank you. Next question from Anne McMurray. Ian, some centres use a second dose of dexamethasone if admitted. Yeah. Do you think one is sufficient as per your slide?
So I was hoping Anne would be on this because Anne is doing some really good work about nomenclature and language that we use in asthma. And I think that'll be really important going forward. I was thinking of you, Anne, as I said that about severe asthma before. I personally don't think you need a second dose of dexamethasone. I think the whole value of the first dose of dexamethasone is that it's a big, it's a really big, strong, long acting dose. Senthil, who you see here, is a endocrinologist who I think inside would be pleased with that answer, that you should give one dose of dex rather than two doses of dex. We don't know about the adrenal side effects of dexamethasone compared to prednisone, but I know, Senthil, you've got concerns about this. But I think for me, one dose of dex is probably equivalent to 3 days of pred. Two doses of dex is a pretty strong and fairly, in my opinion, unneeded dose, and our local audit data that we haven't sort of shared particularly is that you don't need two doses.
Thank you. Next question, Maranimus. Why are inhalers better than NEBs?
So why are inhalers better than NEBs? Good question. So firstly, so in the adult world about 10-15 years ago, people started saying we're killing people with salbutamol, and that's how adult physicians talk, you know, and actually their patients are so frail that you probably were. Overuse of salbutamol is pro-inflammatory and damaging and can make things worse in airways. And these are pretty high doses that we're giving. So one aspect might be risk of the drug. The second thing is that I think there's a behavioral element to this, as in a human factors element. When you walk into an A&E show, and I'm not kind of picking on ED here, but this is typically where that would happen. But if you walk into a child who's on a nebulizer, you're just less likely to send them home. So I think they're better from that point of view. They also, if a child doesn't need a nebulizer, you know, why are we setting up this thing with the parents that for the rest of their childhood, every time they wheeze, they come and have a nebulizer? You know, there's no evidence that for children who don't need them, it's better. There's evidence that it's harmful.
Okay, thank you very much. Next question.
Last point on that, what I would say is there is a tendency, there's something which is in many people's practice, which is to give three back-to-back combined nebulizers. The combining of salbutamol and ipratropium is very evidence-based. There's good evidence for that. There's no evidence that giving them, or sort of a priori giving them three combined nebulizers, there's no evidence that that is good practice, and again, may make things worse. So we would probably say, if you have to give a nebulizer, give a combined one, give one, review, give another one, review.
Thank you very much. Next question from WhatsApp Shah. Great presentation, thank you. Can you comment on aminophylline use in a status asthmaticus? If you see a child in severe asthma, can you skip magnesium sulfate and try it, or rather go to IV salbutamol?
Okay, so a good question. To be fair, I didn't talk about this in my talk. Our local practice is a dose of magnesium, and then if required, a loading dose of aminophylline, and if required, then infusion. There's no evidence suggesting that aminophylline is any better or worse than salbutamol IV. We know that in some children it causes toxicity. We did some work looking at this practice of checking the levels and checking they're between 10 and 20. That doesn't mean it. 10 and 20 fell out of the sky. There's a story behind that, which is quite a funny story, but 10 to 20 doesn't mean anything. Children can get toxicity at pretty low levels of aminophylline, and children can be sort of not really benefiting at pretty high levels of aminophylline. Some children respond to it, some children don't. One of our collaborators in the Netherlands and another one in Portugal, we've set up a little bit of a group to look at this. How do you decide which treatment is right for which child with status asthmaticus. My gut feeling is that a lot of the times they're not needed and the children will just get better anyway. I'm not sure if that answered your question. We tend to go aminophylline because it's a bit easier to draw up and less likely to lead to adverse prescription errors.
Okay, thank you, Ian. Next question from Anonymous. How did you get good data on deprivation and poverty? Postcode or the other means?
So for that, we went postcode. Again, you know, we're doing some work at national level about this, where it's more detailed and we're looking at various modifying and confounding factors in children with in our service. We didn't have the resource to do much more than postcode data, but also quite detailed data on that. The best people to ask for your data are the people who bring money in and out of the hospital, because they code it well. So we were using coding data and postcode data.
Next question from Anonymous. Do you advise oral dexamethasone in primary care?
Really good question. I know there are storage issues about dexamethasone. I've never seen this bottle, but apparently it comes in like a massive bottle. And once you open it, it doesn't last very long. I don't know. I think, and this is why I do another talk about why I think flowcharts are bad for patients, because I think it depends on the context. So for some areas and regions, they might say, look, it's absolutely crucial to us that we are seen to be doing the same thing as the hospital. In other areas, they might go, it's just not going to work. I think in primary care, there's no studies looking at dexamethasone versus prednisolone. So I don't know. I think whatever works locally, and in different countries, prednisolone is significantly cheaper and easier to store. So I think it's context specific. Personally, it would be nice for me if everyone was just on the same thing, wherever you are.
Thank you. Next question from Anonymous. In preschool intermittent episodes of wheeze, do you recommend inhaled corticosteroids?
So going back to that slide, our feeling would be if you've gone through the diagnostic process and you've said interval symptoms, severity and frequency of exacerbations, and markers of inflammation, if you say, yeah, they've got those things, it's asthma, then I probably would. If it's falling in the realms of, no, they don't have asthma, they have episodic viral wheeze, I think there's no benefit of steroids. You may make things worse by altering the microbiome and you affect their long-term plans. So by the time these guys are applying to join the US Navy or whatever, they'll look back through their primary care records and go, no, you've got asthma, you can't go to space, you can't do this stuff. So I think steroids in that group, if they're well, I don't use it. I think you're treating the parents if you do that.
Thank you. Next question from Robin. Parents are worried about long-term use of inhaled corticosteroids and the effect on growth and puberty. What's your views?
So the effect on growth is that there is an effect on growth. I think the effect on growth is minimal. So the evidence would suggest that it's, if you put someone on sort of reasonably high or medium dose inhaled steroids for most of their childhood, you might reduce their adult height by 1 to 1.5 to 2 centimeters, which is, again, central, probably not much compared to what you see in your endocrine clinics. Poorly controlled asthma has also got an impact on growth and puberty. So again, it's about getting the risks and balances right. I think there are other risks of asthma, such of steroids, such as adrenal insufficiency. But I think, again, you know, the risks of not being on inhaled steroids if you have asthma outweigh the risks of those side effects. Again, it's always about monitoring risk. It's always about being honest with families and monitoring risk. We have very few families who don't want inhaled steroids. They can become really difficult to manage, as in the kids can be difficult to manage.
Next is an interesting question from Anonymous. Looks like this question should be for Boris Johnson, but it's actually for you. In your opinion, what's the first step to tackling poverty in developed countries?
So I won't give you the first step because I'll probably get in trouble with our communications team. But that's to do with, I guess, sort of
a diplomatic answer.
Yeah, I guess that's to do with it. For me, the first step about poverty is to accept that it is not the fault of the people who are in poverty. In the developed world, there's very much this kind of way of thinking which is that people are in poverty and it's their fault and they've got every opportunity to get out of it. And even if you're in poverty, you can still eat healthy food, and how dare you smoke, and why are you stressed, and blah, 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 blah. We know that children lose out most, and we know that poor children lose out more than other children. So I think the first step is for the whole of the developed world to take a step back and go, poverty is a concern for all of us. Even if you are only interested in the economy, even if your sole interest and reason for being is big corporations, you still need to tackle poverty, because a healthy and a sort of group of people who are less rich than the rich people, who still have money to spend, is far more productive for the economy than a group that can't afford to buy anything. So whoever we are, we need to put it right at the top of the list of priorities, and we need to completely shoot down false narratives, false arguments about poverty. Same with race, same with women's rights, same with environmental rights, same with all of the things that just get shot down as fake news. They are not fake news. These things are happening and they're real. And I think that would be my...
Yeah, and I know you can go on this. This is real passion.
I could see from your look.
I'm going to bring you back to Asma. We got a few more questions on Asma. So next question from Ismail. How much does rhinitis contribute to the diagnosis of asthma?
Really good question. I think as part of the process of thinking through A2P, I think rhinitis is an important thing to think about alongside eczema and hay fever. There is a group of people, a group of children with asthma and rhinitis. And typically speaking, and I may be wrong in saying, and again, this varies between children, but children who have asthma and rhinitis, it tends to quite often be the rhinitis, which is part, the major driver of the problem. And they're a different phenotype of child to treat. But they do respond well with nasal washouts, and they do respond well to nasal steroids in the majority of cases. So I think there's kids with asthma, there's kids with allergic rhinitis, and there's a group in the middle that we tend to leave to our allergists and ENT colleagues to sort out.
Next question from Vastav Shah. You mentioned all asthma kids should be on inhaled corticosteroids. So the stepwise approach to drugs for asthma treatment that we see in the textbooks or guidelines, do we ignore the step one where it says occasional use of sharp bronchodilators?
Yeah, that's been a discrepancy between different national and international guidelines for a few years. But I think more recently, everybody would agree that we should move away from that. So apart from children with episodic mild wheeze, I think we've moved away from the idea of giving someone salbutamol and seeing if it helps. I think the standard should be, if you've given a diagnosis of asthma, give steroids. Good question.
Next question from Anonymous. Do you think we should be doing more blood testing in primary care for eosinophils and RAST, or is that more for specialist assessment?
Really good question. My disclaimer is that I've never worked in primary care other than sitting in as a medical student and going, this is too difficult. I can't possibly do this job. It's a really good question. Again, I think it depends on the availability of services and local expertise. I think thinking through that, I think it comes down to this. If you've got a preschool child and you're not sure whether they've got asthma, I doubt many paediatricians would begrudge a GP sending that referral. We tend to do it more in hospitals, but that's because I think GPs quite appropriately are sending through preschoolers with equivocal diagnoses who may equally have, well, not equally, but may have CF or lymphoma or laryngomalacia. So they're right to question the diagnosis. So I think it depends on local circumstances, but it's a very good question.
Thank you. Next question from Ismail. If severe asthma is controlled on daily inhaled corticosteroids, do you try and reduce to intermittent? And if so, over what period of time?
We are currently this year doing some evidence-based medicine work around how to step down treatments. The answer is we don't really know how to step anything down. We do this really mean thing from hospitals where we see kids in clinic and we go, you're really well now, go to your GP and they will wean your asthma treatment. And that's quite mean, because actually there is no evidence for how to do anything. The evidence would suggest from the randomized controlled trials in children that if you step down from daily to intermittent steroids, there's a group of kids who might get worse again. There's a group of kids who'll be fine, and there'll be a group of kids who will be fine because they've actually just grown out of their asthma anyway. And you don't know, there is no way of predicting which group they will fall in. So I would say that whatever strategy you go for, work it through with the parents. There's no evidence to be bound or one way or the other, black and white. I think it's got to be a shared decision about how they do it, when they do it. But I think the key is monitoring afterwards. The last thing you want to do is step down treatment, discharge them and say, okay, wean this yourself. You know, it's important that that's done in a stepwise, logical fashion, whatever that fashion might be. So yeah, I think there are some kids that we have probably done it, but usually we usually I chicken it and give it to primary care to do.
Thank you. Anonymous, do you use FENO for diagnosis of asthma?
We do, not in all children, because it does cost a little bit of money each time you do it. And in some children, you probably don't need it. It's a flawed test in some ways, in that it varies anyway. There are some children with without asthma who have high FeNO. There are some children with asthma who don't. But I think if you were going to invest in one piece, if your boss said you can buy one piece of equipment to aid with the diagnosis of asthma, that would be it. I think a negative, it's a little bit like all these things. It's the trend which is important. And if you're questioning the diagnosis and you've never had a raised FeNO, you'd go, really? If it's high, it's very suggestive of inflammation. If it fits with the history, I think it can be a useful thing. We're still finding our feet with FeNO, you know, 15, 20 years afterwards. And we and others are involved in some randomized controlled trials. The Ricino study is a study that's just finished, looking at monitoring asthma with FeNO. So I think it has a role. If you had a choice of taking a history or doing a FeNO, history every time. But I think the FeNO can add to the puzzle.
Thank you. Next question from Sazia. How does exercise-induced wheeze would fit into this? Teenagers with only exercise-induced wheeze but no other symptoms, how would you manage?
Okay, so I mentioned Claire Hepworth, our physiotherapist, before. We do a breathlessness clinic for children and young people with disproportionate breathlessness or also really high-level athletes. I'm not convinced that there are huge numbers of children with exercise-induced bronchoconstriction on its own. Typically speaking, these children will present with other features of asthma. And I think I would move towards, in the adolescent group, saying, look, if you're so mild with your symptoms that you're not even sure whether you have asthma, I think in the first instance, what I would try would be intermittent use of inhaled steroids and LABA. So I think I would probably put them on in the UK, Symbicort, and say, take this on days when you do exercise, see what happens. If you've got facilities to do exercise testing and really clinch that diagnosis of exercise-induced breathlessness, I think that would be important. But again, I think it comes back to the history. If they are really complaining of exercise-induced chest tightness and wheeze, that responds to short-acting or long-acting, fast-acting bronchodilators, and fine, maybe it is exercise-induced bronchoconstriction. But we, in our breathlessness clinic, work through, is it anxiety? Are they just not as fit as they think they are? Do they have a cardiovascular problem? Could it be an upper airway problem, in particular vocal cord dysfunction or exercise-induced laryngeal obstruction? I think I'm often reluctant to give a diagnosis of exercise-induced bronchoconstriction without ticking off all the other things that were on that list. Anxiety probably being number one on that list.
Okay, thank you very much. Next question. What do you think about administering albuterol or inhaled corticosteroids via MDA with spacer and mask versus MDA with spacer and mouthpiece?
I think it comes down to the age. Ideally, what we want is for children to take it through a mouthpiece without a mask, but in younger children, that can be difficult. It's a little bit like when you see people walking around with like dummies and pacifiers and things. Sometimes you just need to take it out and go, you'll be all right. Nothing bad will happen without this. And it's a little bit similar. People get used to the face mask and it actually becomes counterproductive. It's less good for drug delivery, particularly, you know, in some of the kids, it's less good for drug delivery. And it sort of perpetuates the thing. As soon as they're kind of, you know, nobody in school should have a mouthpiece. I would say sometime around three-ish, they should be able to do this without a mouthpiece. It depends on the child and it depends on the resources that you have. But it's another reason that everybody should be investing in multidisciplinary approaches, because frankly, in my clinic, I don't have that time to sit with families and talk through this. We rely so heavily on our nurses and our pharmacists to do that for us. But yeah, it's a good question.
Thank you. And I think you'll be pleased. This is the last question. Next one from Anonymous. What's the indication for oral steroids in preschool wheeze?
Oh, so I purposely left that out because it's so good. What's the indication for oral steroids in preschool wheeze? Okay, there's a slightly long answer to this and I'll break this down. So we did a meta-analysis, which I didn't put in here. Happy to share separately. We're about to publish. But basically, the meta-analysis of RCTs of oral steroids to children in, you know, when they present to ED. If you were to look at that, you would say there is no significant benefit, either clinically or statistically, significant benefit in giving oral steroids to preschool children with wheeze. The caveat with that is that there is, and again, I think this group, so Francine Ducharme is a great person in asthma, and she works in Canada, and they looked observationally at their admissions, and they found that in preschool children with high PRAM scores, so kids who are severely unwell, giving steroids early can prevent either deterioration or speed up recovery, I can't remember which, but they felt that giving steroids to sick preschoolers in ED was worthwhile. We talked about this locally and my feeling was no preschool children in ED should have oral steroids. And the reason I said that was because the value of oral steroids is to prevent admission. So if they're going home, they don't need steroids. If they're coming in, you can may as well give steroids when they're in, and then it takes away from ED, you know, often someone quite junior in ED having to make that, in an emergency department having to make that decision. So for me, I think a lot of times when we're giving oral steroids to preschoolers, they probably didn't need them. I think there is a group of kids who might benefit from them, but I think unless they're really severely unwell, I probably wouldn't. And I think if I was going to do it or, you know, set that up in my department, it would be something that would need to be discussed as a team, particularly with, you know, a senior doctor there, you know, a consultant or registrar or, you know, attending something. So I think having a team discussion about it is better than having a flowchart. It goes back to this thing that I firmly believe this, that flowchart-based medicine can be bad for children. And if you draw a flowchart for oral steroids for preschoolers, loads of kids will get it who don't need it. Loads of kids won't get it who probably do need it. We don't know how best to qualify who does need it. But I think the two times I would give it would be if there's someone with a clear history of asthma who is on asthma treatment. You know, if a child is coming in on inhaled steroids with a letter saying this child has atopic asthma and happens to be 4.5, absolutely give them steroids. If that'd be one group, and the second group would be the children who, despite initial treatment with nebulizers, are still potentially hypoxic and coming in, you know, I think I'd give it then. But I'd have a pretty high threshold for giving such a dangerous treatment to such a vulnerable group. I didn't answer your question. I skirted around the question and said, I don't know, ask your team. But I think, honestly, I think this is where team decisions are the right thing, and team decisions made in conjunction with a parent are the right way to do it. Risk and benefit.
Thank you very much. I said that was the last question, but one quick last question. Is there any risk of immune suppression with the inhaled corticosteroids?
I'm pretty sure that someone has been Googling the most difficult and hot topics in asthma at the moment. I don't know what to make of the evidence. My feeling is that if you look at large population level studies, being on long-term inhaled steroids increases the risk of a bacterial pneumonia, we think. But those are all observational studies and we don't really know. There seems to be a little bit of a class effect in some papers and not others. But I think for children on anything more than medium doses of steroids, yeah, I think there may well be some immune, as well as the good immune modulatory functions that we want from the steroids, I think there may be some immunodeficient, or not immunodeficiency, but some alterations in the, you know, the protective immune system. And bear in mind, these are often, you know, kids that we're treating with asthma are already prone to different types of infections, particularly rhinovirus types of infections, but other infections as well. You know, asthma in and of itself is a T cell abnormality. So yes, I think in a certain group of kids, it might increase the risk of chest infections. And I think that's something that we should be discussing again with parents and on the lookout for those sorts of things. I don't think we look for it as well as we should, and I think more research will happen, but I would suspect that we'll go around in circles a little bit with the answer for that. Every 10 years it seems to cycle depending on what's the most recent systematic review, but yes, you're exactly right. I think there probably is a risk of knocking the immune system a little bit. Again, I think the risks of doing that are outweighed by the risks of having a significant asthma attack in children with uncontrolled asthma.
Thank you very much, Jan. I think that brings us to the end of the session. We ran over time a little bit, but I think there were loads of questions and lots of interaction from our audience, and you handled it so well and answered and enlightened them with all your knowledge and wisdom. And that was really an inspiring session. Thank you so much for your time and contributing to the GPLS. So we'll meet again next week, 4 o'clock, next Wednesday, 4 p.m. UK time for another session. One of our child psychiatric colleagues is going to give an interesting session next week. You can find the joining link on our webpage, Aldergate website and Aldergate Academy webpage. Any queries in between, please do email the academy@aldergate.nhs.uk. See you all next week. Thank you very much.